15 years, blowing the doors off the competition. Podcasting to planet Earth.
PNRNetworks.com.
Stay here.
You stay here. That guy's a zombie.
There's no such thing.
Oh, right, because that's perfectly normal. I can't believe this is happening.
Cavebabble. Hello and welcome to Cave Babble episode 278. This week's episode, Anna and the Apocalypse. This episode is brought to you by Killer Classmates.
Killer Classmates.
Hi everyone, this is Eric.
And this is Valerie.
Welcome to our podcast. Let's say right up front, if you have not seen... Okay, you've seen the title and you've heard the title. If you have not seen this movie... Please go see this movie because we are going to be spoiling things during this movie.
Yes, podcast. And you want to watch this movie. Don't listen to the podcast first. Stop now and watch this movie. I think we can say definitely it's a 2 thumbs up. And according to IMDb, it actually is increasing in popularity. And I think so. I think it should. I think if you haven't seen this, this is a jewel. And yes, it is a Christmas. It's a Christmas theme. Mm-hmm. That's why we watched it, because it's all about Christmas.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, remember when we did our Thanksgiving episode and I said we wouldn't do something like that for Christmas, that it would be a nice movie? It is a nice movie.
Yeah, it is. Uh-huh.
It's the brains are nice and the entrails are nice and the blood is nice and the songs are nice.
I like it because it's not your typical, you know, Christmas movie.
Well, it's certainly not that. You got that right.
It's kind of a Christmas movie along the lines that Die Hard is a Christmas movie, would you say?
No, because I think it has more to do with Christmas than that. They have a whole play.
Yeah, oh, that's true. They do have a whole Christmas play. Yeah, you're right.
So what are we talking about? 2017's Anna and the Apocalypse.
Young Anna was nestled, all snug in her bed, not knowing tomorrow she'd meet the undead. How would she survive? What this season would bring? Well, that's simple. She'd stab, she'd slash, and she'd sing.
Directed by John McPhail.
And we saw it streaming on what?
Amazon Prime.
Amazon Prime.
Your results
Director
may vary.
Director John McPhail. Well, he definitely is not a failure. He actually studied in the cinematography at the Royal Conservatoire of Scotland. And he formed his production company named Worrying Drake Productions.
Yeah.
In 2013, he was producing a trilogy of short comedy films, Notes, V for Visa, Doug and Steve Big Hold Adventure. While he was doing that, he wrote a 3-minute film called Just Say Hi that he entered into the 2013 Virgin Media Shorts competition.
Yeah.
He is the only director to actually have received multiple awards during this festival. He won 2 out of the 3 awards available, and he's the only director to date that has won multiple awards. So yeah. Kudos to him.
And of course, we've never heard of him
until
this. So.
Until this, yeah. Mm-hmm.
What in the world is this about? Anna and the Apocalypse. How can this be a Christmas movie, babe?
Well, because it says. It says it's a Christmas musical.
Because it says right there. It
says right there on the title.
Okay, before we go into cast.
Christmas musical.
What is this about? Here's what it's about. A zombie apocalypse threatens the sleepy town of Little Haven at Christmas, forcing Anna and her friends to fight, slash, and sing their way to survival. facing the undead in a desperate race to reach their loved ones. But they soon discover that no one is safe in this new world, and with civilization falling apart around them, the only people they can truly rely on are each other. There you go.
Isn't that true in general? That the only people you can rely on are yourself and sometimes not even your closest friends, but you definitely can rely on yourself.
Yeah. So Christmas classics go something like this. It's a Wonderful Life, Anna and the Apocalypse, and Miracle on 34th Street, right? Aren't those the big three?
Yeah, I think they're very similar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So this is, I'm sure.
This needs to be added to your family Christmas classic. Well, not young children. I wouldn't show it to your young children, but definitely, tween? Well, it's rated R, isn't it?
It's really gross, honestly.
So rated R. Keep that in mind.
It is rated R.
So I guess, yeah, you gotta at least be older teens, not your tweens.
This movie debuted at the 2017 Fantastic Fest Film Festival. That's easy for me to say. Fantastic Fest Film Festival in Austin, Texas, September 22nd, 2017.
And that's where it debuted, huh?
Mm-hmm. That's where it debuted. And it said many in the cast, including the star, saw the film for the first time at that premiere. So
interesting, because this whole film was filmed, produced in Scotland. And so for it to debut in Texas is interesting.
Yeah, it's a Scottish film. It was filmed in Port Glasgow, which is outside of Glasgow. It's out on the coast I had it up on a map, out on the coast of, I say coast, it's on the River Clyde, which is huge right there, so it's really, it doesn't matter.
So this thing, a lot of parts of it was, several areas of that town were featured, of course, in this film. Of course it would, because that's where it was filmed. But, the high school, a little bit of trivia on the high school where it was filmed, is in 2017, I guess obviously it was a deserted high school, no longer in use, but they demolished it in 2019, this 2 years later.
Yeah. So now we can't go visit the high school?
No, now we can't even go through with our little webcam and our GoPro and the deserted high school. Yeah.
Oh, man. So probably the headmaster isn't even there either, huh? We couldn't even meet him.
No, because the headmaster then later went on to have a role in Game of Thrones?
I don't know. You're asking the wrong person. I mean, I love Game of Thrones, but yeah, I didn't know that about him.
You're talking about Arthur Savage.
Yes, Arthur, played by Paul Kay.
Paul Kay, yeah. So he also played a character in the Game of Thrones.
I just don't remember him, that's all.
Actually, he did that first, because he did Game of Thrones in 2011. It's
been a long time.
Thronos of Myr.
He's the Thronos of the Game of Thrones.
Yeah, he's Thronos of Myr, and he...
Of course he is.
Uh-huh, and he was killed by a zombie bear.
I don't remember these things. We have to go back and watch the series again.
See, right. So, of course, that's why he would play in this. He's already used to being around zombies from Game of Thrones.
How did I not know that he was killed by a zombie? I should remember that scene, and I do not remember a scene with a zombie bear.
I have to say, I had to look it up and look at his Game of Thrones character. And then I said, oh, yeah, okay, I remember him.
See, I'm sure I would do the same thing if I looked him up.
He was born 1965 in London, England. He has a twin sister.
Oh, he does?
Yeah.
Was she in Game of Thrones, and was she killed by a zombie eagle?
No, they don't give much on her. Don't even give me her name. Just says he had a twin. She's a year older than him. An hour older. A twin who's an hour older than him, not a year.
You know that's staying in the show, right?
Yeah. He's got to. A twin who's a year. No, he's an hour older than him. Yeah. 1 hour older than him.
Oh, my God. Okay, that's all the time we have for today, everybody. Hope you. Thanks for all the downloads and listens. Yeah. Okay. Let's go through this star list. Now we've spoiled Paul K ahead of time. You remember that scene in Game of Thrones when they were on Mars, right?
Well, see, we've already talked about him, so now we can get on with the rest of the cast.
Yeah, well, because they won't take as long because most of them have nothing in their bios.
Oh, poor things.
We have Ella Hunt playing Anna Shepherd. Why doesn't she just play Ella?
Oh, it's hard to hide when the truth inside rises up like a tidal wave. There's been some.
Why can't it be Ella and the Apocalypse?
Well, Anna and the, you know, two A's. You've got your alliteration going on.
Yeah, okay. I guess so. Why do we... Oh, okay, we'll talk about...
She was born April 29th, 1998. She was best known, I guess, for her role in Intruders in 2011. She was in Les Miserables in 2012.
Your French is great.
Les Miserables. I know. I apologize to my French teacher. You don't use it, you lose it.
You notice I didn't even try, so.
I once used to be able to speak French. As you can see, I took no longer French. Can.
I can't speak French. I took it. It was one of the subjects I took one time in high school. Why didn't I take Spanish? It would have been so much better.
Well, I took French at the time because we lived close to the Canadian border, and where we lived, French was spoken more than Spanish, so hence why I took French. Yeah. And I did use it growing up and living in that area, but then after I moved from that location, then Spanish now would have been a whole lot more useful, yes.
I learned American.
You learned American.
I learned American. And I've been using it all my life. Hmm. Okay, do you have any other... See, what else do you have on her? I bet you have next to nothing. She's English.
Yep, she's
not
English
Scottish.
Actress.
She's English.
She had her first live performance at the Boston Children's Opera when she was six. She sang the song Turning that is in the soundtrack. So at 6 years old, she sang a song from the soundtrack of Les Miserables, and it was Turning.
You know, that's one thing we can say is the cast, well, with the exception of Paul K, who is supposed to have a kind of a bad voice, they all have great voices.
Yeah, and you said that they all sang their own parts, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, they are. Yeah. I mean, they are credited in the song list as them. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they did. I do have to say they all had, you know, excellent, yes, singing voices, except for Arthur Savage. Yeah. All came.
Okay, next we have Malcolm Cumming as John. Yeah, John doesn't even get a last name.
Oh, I've been lying, I've been cheating, I've been fooling myself. Instead of fighting, I've been hiding away. I've been running, going nowhere, put my heart on the shelf, and I don't want to live that way.
I know, poor guy. Anna's best friend.
Yep, they are not boyfriend and girlfriend.
He wishes the opposite. He wishes they were more than best friends.
Yeah, he has a thing for her, but he doesn't sit there and pine after her through the whole movie. It's like he just, I don't know how to describe it. It's not your typical jilted guy. He's just having a good time with her. He's not pressing anything or, you know, pressing the issue or doing anything like that.
He is enjoying being her best friend,
yep,
but yeah,
he
of course would like it to be more, but yeah, he doesn't, you know, isn't, like you said, forcing that.
No.
But hey. Yeah, there's no bio. It doesn't give his date of birth.
We know nothing about him.
Yeah, it just says that he was in Spaceship in 2019 and Long Lost in 2017, and that's it, poor guy.
He was killed by a zombie llama in Game of Thrones back in 2012.
He was never in Game of Thrones.
He was in Game of Thrones. He was really young then. He was quite young then. Well, not that wasn't that long ago, but that was a really shocking scene. I remember that. Ugh, God, zombie llamas. You would not think that would be any big deal, but good God.
All I know is I want his ugly Christmas sweater.
That is an ugly Christmas sweater, and he wore it multiple days, didn't he?
Well, I don't think so. I think this all kind of took place in a 24-hour period, didn't it?
Well, she woke up the next day, and that's when things were going to hell, right? Because she came out of her house, didn't she?
Oh, that's true.
And she was walking down the street.
Did.
That was one of my favorite scenes when that was all going down.
Well, if anyone purchases, you know, people who purchase an ugly sweater, you wear it for multiple days because, you know, this you're very limited on when you can wear it, and they're usually fairly costly. So, yeah, you're going to wear the heck out out of it during the Christmas season, I would imagine.
Those of you with ugly Christmas sweaters, you know they're expensive.
Yeah, come right. Come on. And I bet you wear yours to heck, too, don't you? Don't you?
Yeah, wear the hell out of it. Anyway, I like him. I like John. I like his dancing style, which is all over the place.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That's pretty mm-hmm. funny. Just like that. That's exactly...
Blah, 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 just like that.
Just how that sounded, imagine seeing that. And that's what it was like. Okay, let's move on to Sarah Swire. Hey, she's an American. She played Steph North.
Am I lying? Am I cheating? Am I fooling myself? Why should they listen to what I have to say? Am I just another nobody like everyone else? Because I don't want to live that way.
She has a last name.
Yeah, they gave her a last name, but that's it. She, too, has nothing in her bio about her age. She acted in Impulse in 2018.
Has
One
a great
Man Flash
voice.
Mom. Oh, I love her, voice.
Her singing voice is fantastic.
I think out of the female singers, I liked her voice the best.
I think I did, too. Yeah, I enjoyed mm-hmm. hers the most as well.
Yeah.
And there you go. And that's all we have on her. This is easy, man.
Yeah.
We have Christopher Laveau as Chris Weiss. Hey, see, Christopher and Chris.
Staring at a screen in a neon haze. Whoa, lost in this machine and I can't engage.
See how easy that is?
So how easy they... Now, isn't this terrible? Like, can't remember which one was Chris.
He's the kisser. He's the other half of the kissing couple.
Oh, he was the kisser. Okay. Mm-hmm. He was the other half of the kissing couple. Okay. His he was in the Battle for Middle Earth in 2009.
Oh, really? So he was in a video game? Isn't that Battle for Middle Earth is a video
1066,
game.
The Battle for Middle Earth. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, they have that credited to him.
1066. The Battle for Middle-earth was a docudrama miniseries about the Norman conquest of England. Other than containing no orcs, it's practically the same thing as the video game. Truly.
Yeah, again, yeah, there's just really not much of anything on these actors and actresses, which is sad because I thought they all played their parts very well. So, maybe they just like living a private life. I mean, they don't want to be all paparazzied.
Maybe somehow this movie has not made them famous, babe.
Well, it needs to, you know, and that's what we're here for. We are here to help make this movie famous. So please, listeners, if you haven't seen this, turn off this podcast now and go watch it.
Yeah, but come right back to it because our podcast has an expiration time of 4 hours. Yeah. You didn't know that?
I didn't know that.
Oh, yeah. When you download our podcast, you only have 4 hours to listen to it.
Oh,
and then. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Like Mission Impossible.
Absolutely.
It burns up.
Mm-hmm. So you need to go watch this movie right now and then come right back to this episode.
I don't think you want to promote that because people aren't going to want to replace their electronic devices, you know, every time they listen to our podcast.
It just gets rid of our podcast.
Oh, okay. Not the whole device like in Mission Impossible where the whole thing, you know.
Yeah. It gets
just the pod.
Mm-hmm. It gets rid of the whole podcast and then kills your firstborn.
And if you believe that, yeah, you guys, yeah.
I mean, there is that
not been a fan of ours for all the years we've been doing this.
trust me. I mean, I tried to opt out of the whole killing the firstborn thing, but it didn't work. Sorry.
Yeah, but unfortunately, popcorn and roses require that of us.
That's right. That's T.C. Kirkham and Kim Brown.
That's part of being part of their network requires your firstborn.
E-Cinema One. Go check them out. There's our ad. Love you, T.C.
Sorry, T.C. and Kim. No, they're back and they're listening saying, wait, what? No.
But gosh,
untruthful.
Darn it. Why did you make us kill children? As you can tell, we have nothing to talk about in this movie. Okay, we have...
Well, but they do kill children.
They do kill children. A baby gets eight. And Christopher... Chris, I should say, because he doesn't get the Topher on his name.
No Topher, just Chris.
On his name, he has one of those smiles that is like open mouth, all teeth smiles. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you definitely get to see his dental... No, well, it's not dental work. You just get to see his teeth, which are pretty straight. So there you go.
All the more for Lisa. Lisa loves Chris's teeth. She's always licking them.
Oh, let's talk about her. That is Marley Sue.
There's a lack of presence in my stocking, and my chimney needs a good unblocking. Come on, Santa, dear.
The kissing couple. See, I know when you guys watch this film, you'll get it. You'll get why they're the kissing couple.
And what is up with those people? They obviously want to be seen. I'm talking in general in high school or whatever you call it.
Oh yeah, I think they're supposed. This is. I think they're supposed to be high school kids. Yes.
Yeah, and I know. Then, I know they
think
are.
Think back to your high school days. You had a boyfriend or girlfriend during high school, I didn't. I wasn't allowed to. So it was. Oh. But yeah, you know, you were always looking at those happy couples, you know, and just coveting that hugging, kissing, you know, and.
Yeah,
Weren't you?
Yeah, I totally had a girlfriend. She just lived in Canada.
Oh, so you weren't. No. Oh, you had one of those.
No, I did not.
Oh, yeah, I've got a girlfriend. She's in Canada. Yeah,
she lives in Canada.
Yeah, right.
I totally have a girlfriend. We totally make out all the time. I fly up there and she flies down here and we totally make out. And then she goes back home.
Yeah, we have to make out a lot because we got to make up for that full year in that short period of time. Yeah.
No, I had a girlfriend back then. I always had a girlfriend. And sorry.
Oh, okay.
But I did.
You were allowed to at least have a girlfriend. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, not that my... Anyway, let's not go there.
Yeah, let's not. This is not a podcast about...
Not
Erica
that my
Bell's
family knew about.
Unsatisfied dating years as a teenager.
Just in general, this movie doesn't make me want to go back to high school anytime soon.
Yeah, I can't. I can't say high school were my favorite years. No.
Nope. Mm-hmm. Nope. Mine weren't. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's move on because this is too painful. No, she has a nice voice. They all have nice voices. Let's just assume all across the board, everybody has a nice voice, including this guy.
You really want to go back to them? Some of you may want to, but...
Do you want to go back to high school? Some of you are barely out of high school. Some of you may not even be out of high school, so...
That's true.
How is it for you? How's it going for you? Do you have a girlfriend or boyfriend? Or both?
High school at these periods of time are really weird with the pandemic. I bet you they're feeling gypped.
No. Yeah. I don't know how they're feeling.
I wouldn't have felt gypped, you know. It would have been the same. So nothing would have changed with a pandemic for me.
I didn't have a boyfriend to miss anyway.
I didn't have a life in high school.
I had no boyfriend to miss, so it's all good.
Yeah, because see, you have to have a boyfriend to have a life. No, at least that's what you think when you're in high school. Anyways, we're not
Ben
talking about
Wiggins.
High
Ben Wiggins.
Ben Wiggins.
Plays Nick. The jerk former boyfriend who, what, spread the rumor that he slept with her?
Yeah,
no, he didn't. He said others.
In my high school, I would have coveted him as a boyfriend. Yeah, except he was a jerk, wasn't he?
He was a complete jerk.
He was
jerk,
very
babe.
Nice.
No, he was, I mean, there was that turning moment where we learned a little bit more about him.
Right. You get to like him at the end. You get to understand why he's a jerk. Yeah. He has your typical sounds like military dad who doesn't look like he gave him a lot of...
overbearing at home. Yeah.
There you go. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But he ended up killing him.
He plays in The Witcher.
He's in Witcher?
He's in The Witcher. Uh-huh.
Yeah. See? Was he killed by
a zombie?
What was he killed by?
The Witcher. You know,
he was killed by The Witcher.
The Witcher was just one season, right? We're still waiting for
we're waiting for season two. And
season two.
Yeah. COVID times, just wait some more.
Yeah.
But yeah, you know, he has a good voice.
But he has a good voice.
And he likes to do the killing. There's one of your killer classmates right there. He was into it.
He was, yeah.
Along with the...
He has a whole song segment with him showing his...
Right.
This was perfect for him.
Let's just put a little bit of that right here. See, there's his voice. Don't you like it?
Yeah, actually, out of all the male actors, I think he has the best singing voice.
I ought to just put a little bit of the singing after I say all of the names. Just to have a little bit of their voice.
Yeah.
And they sound just like that.
Then our listeners can, you know, also decide which one they like best. But I liked Sarah Swires. So Steph Norf and Nick Ben Wiggins, their voices.
Well, let's try that with ours at the beginning. Hi, everyone. This is Eric. And I am a co-host of a podcast.
I already sang. It's like, oh, these poor faces. Oh, wait, but you probably didn't capture it because I say, I'm singing.
Yeah. Oh, that was at the beginning.
And all I'm doing is singing.
I'm opening my mouth and words are coming out.
And I'm just changing the reflection of my voice. And that's called singing.
The reflection?
For those of you who love the Christmas classic Elf.
Yeah. Wow. Okay, let's move on now.
But we all know that you and our daughter Courtney have the better singing voice, have good singing voices, not me.
Which was not on display in what I just sang, by the way.
No. Mm-hmm.
All right, now we're going to move on. We have Mark Benton playing Tony Shepard, who is Anna's dad. And also, something that was distracting to me, his eyes look so much like Brian Cox's eyes that he could be related. As a matter of fact, I wondered if they weren't related, and I went and looked it up afterward, and they're not.
Benton was born in North Yorkshire, England.
Okay, he's English. Okay, Mark
he's
Benton's
English,
English and Brian Cox is a guy.
He's well known in Britain, by the way.
I'm sure he is.
For his, quote, brand new customers only, quote, line on the advertisements for Nationwide Building Society.
Oh, okay. He's known for commercials.
Yeah, I guess. Uh-huh. His uncle is the actor Michael Gunn.
Michael Gunn.
Has nothing to do with your...
Brian Cox?
Yeah, Brian Cox.
Imagine Brian Cox with not graying hair yet. That's also known as having dark hair. Imagine Brian Cox, a younger, oh man, I'm just messing this all up. Never mind. Go look at Brian Cox and look at Mark Benton. Just in certain, you know, when they turn to the side and in the eyes, definitely the eyes, they have the same kind of...
Yeah, just look at the eyes.
The eyes are most definitely very similar.
The key to the soul.
All right, we already talked about Paul K, so let's move on. Now, can I talk about the jerks? Let's
talk about the jerks. Yeah, I can talk about
the jerks. We have Sean Connor, John Winchester, and Ewan Bennett, who all play, as I call, Graham, Tibbsy, and Jake in order. And I call them Asshole 1, Asshole 2, and Asshole 3.
Yeah, they were mixed gang.
Yeah, and they just blend in with one another. And as we're watching this on Prime, they have the little X-ray thing that shows little bits of trivia and shows you who is in each scene that pops up if you have that on. They don't even show up in their scenes. They show the leads in those scenes, and they don't even show up on that little X-ray thing.
They play the typical high school bully group.
Jerks.
And that everybody who has gone through high school knows of that group of jerks. Yeah, bullying their way through life.
Mm-hmm. They're the ones that everyone acts like they love, because if you're not on their good side, you get the crap beaten out of you.
Exactly.
Get messed with. So you act like they are the most popular kids in school until you graduate, and then F them. I'm not angry, and I totally had a girlfriend in Canada. I did.
I was part of one of those gangs. I wouldn't even want to be part of one of those gangs. Yeah. That's.
They didn't mess with me because they knew that I had skills, and if they would have come over, I would have gotten in my stance, babe. Have you seen my stance? My stance was really cool back then.
Yeah, they did it to pick on me because I was too little to, they probably didn't even see me.
Oh, no.
I was too little.
I didn't have a boyfriend and I wasn't even seen in high school.
I think I was invisible while I was in high school. Yeah.
Did they during your graduation? Did they say who was that?
It's like who? What?
What?
Graduation? I don't even remember graduating. No,
that's why graduation is so long, because all these strangers keep walking across the stage.
It's like, where'd she come from? I don't remember her.
That's as far as I'm going in the cast list. That
I mean,
there's like the one that plays the aunt. What's her name? The guy's what is his name? Chris's. Wasn't it his aunt?
His grandma.
Aunt? Oh, it was his grandma, not his aunt. It was his grandma.
His grandma.
That's true. He's really young and she's really old.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So anyway, there were others. Go look them up.
There's not much on them.
Okay, so tell me this. I am completely burned out on zombie movies. Why in the world did we watch another zombie movie? Do we need another zombie movie at this point?
But this one was different than any other zombie movie, I would think. Wouldn't you say? So who has ever put together a zombie movie with a musical?
Well, I'll tell you who did.
Okay, who?
It's Ryan McHenry did.
Oh,
and this film is dedicated to him. At the end of the credits, it said it's dedicated to Ryan McHenry. And so I had to look it up, of course. He, sadly, they said, he passed away in 2015, and he wrote and directed the short film Zombie Musical in 2011, from which this feature film was adapted.
Oh, man. So now we need to watch the Zombie Musical.
Like we can get a hold of that.
Oh, we can't get a hold of that.
I really have no idea. No, I didn't. I asked my girlfriend in Canada to do that, and she hasn't gotten back.
She hasn't gotten back to.
She's going to totally get back to me anytime now. Trust me.
Because we just learned about this, so yeah, we haven't had time for her to get back to you yet.
Yeah, I mean, come on, she has things to do, like I don't know, shovel snow and play hockey or something.
Wink, wink.
Sorry, Canada, you're cooler than us. We know you are. Okay, let's jump in.
So during this, like I said, this whole thing takes place around Christmas time.
Yeah.
This high school is having a Christmas concert.
Which is hilarious, of course.
Which is. And one of the trivias is, well, Lisa is singing her song. I love her song, by the way.
You do?
Yeah. I mean, during that song, she does have a good voice during that song. But I still like the other character, Oliver North's
Oliver North?
Oliver North's daughter. Her voice is still the best. The person playing the keyboards is Tommy Riley, mm-hmm. and he co-wrote the music for this film.
Well, there you go. I don't know anything about him other than that, but...
Yeah, other than he co-wrote the music for this he was born in Glasgow, Scotland, also.
Glasgow.
Yeah.
But that's not how those that live there say it.
Yeah.
They pronounce it very strangely.
Do you have a clip that shows how they pronounce it?
People who live there do?
Yeah. No, I don't.
Yeah. No. I know they pronounce it funky, though, different than the rest of the world.
Well, pronounce it correctly. We, the rest of us, pronounce it funky.
Well, I think they pronounce it differently than those others living in Scotland.
I see what you mean.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. They have a weird pronunciation of that. City. I don't know. I say weird. I don't know.
It's just like people who live in the state of Missouri. I hate it when they call it Missouri.
Missouri. That's because you're not a native.
It's Missouri.
That's because we're not natives.
Oh, okay. We're not born and raised here.
Mm. So
Missouri.
Okay, we're jumping into the middle of the movie because the production was, well, not in the middle. It was closer to the beginning, I guess. But when Lisa is singing, why are we okay with suggestive songs sung by underage people?
I think we were okay with it during this movie because it was hilarious how the principal was the headmaster was reacting.
Yeah.
He was conflicted.
Well, it's like, what's his name from school board, the head of the school board or whoever it was that was wearing a sweater that had the circle on, whatever was on that. He was totally into it.
He was the old headmaster. He's on his way out. The circle said retiring.
Oh, it said retiring.
Yeah, that's the old headmaster on his way out that all the kids loved. And then the new headmaster was, conflicted. He was all, this is filth, but yet he was really enjoying it too.
You know, I'm a little disappointed because I specifically tasked my girlfriend in Canada to let me know when I'm going to make mistakes like that in this podcast. And strangely, I have no texts.
Yeah, Eric, you know, that was the old advanced. Retiring.
Oh, wow.
But of course, I could be wrong too. So
you guys, our listeners
need to correct me if I'm, or the, our computer needs to correct me if.
I'm sure you're absolutely right because the whole idea of it, because I remember Anna in the hallway saying she was, no, not Anna, Steph. Steph was going to take her case directly to him, to the guy with the soon to be retired shirt or whatever it was. And yeah, our Savage told her, no, you know, this is my school after he's gone. So,
yeah, so there.
Yeah. So you're right. You're right. And I'm wrong. And I'm getting a new girlfriend. That's all there is to it.
But this movie is a musical. And so most musicals start out with an opening scene, right? And what was this opening scene supposed to be?
You know what, babe? Every movie I've seen has an opening scene.
But a musical opening scene.
A full song.
So they were supposed to be doing a scene featuring a drunk Santa stumbling through the town center while people around him saying, you know, what a time to be alive. So this was supposed to be, but they canceled it because of poor weather conditions. Come on.
Can you imagine poor weather conditions in Scotland?
Yeah, it's like that has to be, you know, a right.
Or just, as they call it in Scotland, Tuesday.
Right.
Why would
you cancel a main feature, a main scene of a musical? I want to see that. I want them to redo this and to do that scene.
I mean, I know everything about Scottish weather because I've seen several movies that take place in the Highlands and they always look nasty cold.
Yeah, it always looks cold.
It's overcast and half spitting rain on them and the wind's blowing.
Whereas this one, that, you know, like I said, was all filmed on location in Scotland, I didn't think showed that at all. It actually felt more English. English school and headmasters, you know, with the.
We're sorry,
but
Scotland.
I shouldn't say that either because England's all fog and there wasn't a lot of fog either. So maybe this was an Americanized version of.
Our stereotypes are great. What else can we do, come up
Aren't
with?
They? Yeah. So maybe this was more Americanized with trying to portray an English high school.
Let's see. What other stereotypes? Crappy food, bad teeth. Let's see.
Crappy food, bad teeth.
And everyone over here is fat and talks like this.
Yeah, that's right. No, they're not quite. They're almost accurate there.
I always like when the English put on a Southern American accent, and that just doesn't quite sound like a Southern accent. It's just not quite the same. You know, just like when we try to do any accents that aren't Midwest, that's all. I can't do those either. Should hear my Canadian girlfriend's voice, though.
I bet you it's hot.
It's so hot, babe. It's so hot. Hey, this is COVID-19 2 years early. COVID-17, right?
Uh-huh.
Isn't that, like at the beginning, wasn't it on the radio or something? They were talking about...
The CDC was warning them.
About a pandemic.
We interrupt this program to bring you an important news bulletin. The Center for Disease Control has recategorized the pandemic, first thought to be a supervirus strain of the flu. It has now been determined to be a lethal pathogen, seemingly capable of
Yep.
Oh my God, it was weird to hear.
And I thought, it was weird.
Oh, it's COVID. So you know what's coming, everybody.
This film predicted it.
Yes,
see?
It did.
And 2 years later, bam, pandemic. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Okay.
It's all their fault, isn't it?
Yes, it's all their fault. We were noticing right off that subtitles are actually a great thing for this movie. Because not only do you catch all the lyrics as they're flying by, which it's easy to understand what they're saying. I'm not saying that it was hard. But seeing them as subtitles and the lyrics and also... the little ancillary things, the background voices, the subtitles show exactly what they're saying, and you can't hear them.
No.
And sometimes that's one of my favorite things about having subtitles on is you get all of that stuff that's supposed to be going on in the background, and you can't hear it. And some of them are really funny. Yeah, this is definitely made for this kind of movie.
I've gotten used to reading the subtitles, but sometimes pay more attention to the subtitles than what the people are saying.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it would move on so fast before I could even get the subtitles read.
Right. You just need to crank it up and watch it again.
Yeah.
There are catchy songs in here. I really enjoy the music for the most part. I mean, it's poppy, you know, but in a good way.
I think my most favorite scene is when, you know, what you talked about when she woke up the next morning.
Yes, definitely.
She woke up the next morning. It's a new morning. She's singing about it's a new morning and everything's so great and fantastic while chaos is ensuing all around her.
I'm waking.
Cars are crashing behind her. People are at one point they're eating a baby
out of a baby.
They're not showing the baby, but they're behind the carriage and you know what's going on.
Eating a baby out of the pram.
They're behind the pram and you see them. Yeah, it's pretty funny.
And tissue bits flying.
Tissue bits. That's what we should say.
Tissue bits.
It should be rated R for tissue bits.
Tissue bits.
One thing I really did enjoy was they are not confused by the term zombie. They know what zombies are. They've all seen movies. They know exactly who is in town.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And throughout, I don't really like it when movies don't acknowledge that zombie films exist. It's like, what is this? Well, we call them the undead, or we call them something else, you know, or the Walking Dead.
Mm-hmm.
They call them the walker, you know, walkers or whatever. It's, no, they're zombies. Everybody knows about zombies. We've had zombie films since the 60s, so let's just act like, you know, all of those touchstones are there, and I like that. It's like, oh, good, you all call them zombies, and you know what they are and what you should do.
And in fact, during this film, the cleaner, the janitor at the bowling alley, her name is Miss Hensman, and that's a shout-out to Bill Hensman, who played a graveyard zombie that kills a character, John. And the original Night of the Living Dead.
Oh,
so
there you go.
That's a specific call out to her. Mm-hmm. And then we also, during this, we find out one of the characters, Chris. Chris, I guess, is a video gamer. And so they always thought that he plays video games. And so the rest of the high school friends that were with him said, well, you know, he knows how to do this, you know, ask Chris, you know. But then he didn't. He was actually almost scared to inactivity.
Yeah.
So the first person, I think, was North, was, yeah, that
was
her character, Steph.
Steph
North. Steph.
You know,
yeah, she was
Ollie's
the one that
daughter.
Actually, Ollie's daughter.
What did you think of Oliver North?
Yeah, Oliver North's daughter. They were in Mexico. They had ditched her, poor thing. She
I don't even
sure.
know if he's still around. I assume Oliver North is still alive. Let's just say I don't run in those circles, so I don't know.
Right, we don't run in other than the fact that wasn't he in Montana while we were in Montana.
No, he had a radio show. I don't even know. I have no idea what he's doing. I don't know.
Okay.
That scene was probably my favorite one. That was the one that I was writing in my notes saying, yes, 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 this is great, this is great. And then they dance through a cemetery, which is even better. I mean, how many dance scenes through a cemetery do you see?
Right, see? Mm-hmm.
And then they decapitate a snowman. So there you go. As a matter of fact, that was probably the second best snowman decapitation I've ever seen.
Do you want to decapitate a snowman?
Would you like to kill a snowman?
There you go.
Yes, I would.
Redo that song.
I did like how they knocked his head off because it was a guy in there in a suit. And then his head was still animated down on the ground. And they were, one of the two, either John or Anna, was trying to argue that it wasn't a zombie apocalypse.
Uh-huh.
And the other one was like, look, just pointing down at the animated head. It's like, what?
Yeah, it was Anna. Anna was in denial. She was denying that that was a zombie. And John was saying, look, that's not normal. Yeah, there's the head talking.
One little bit of trivia, when they had the hashtag evac selfie little bit where they showed little, you know, people filming stuff around the world, of course, which would happen, which is sad but true.
Uh-huh, yeah, it would.
Mm-hmm. One of the little bits showing on that screen was from Ash Campbell, which was a mashup of Ash and Bruce Campbell from Evil Dead. So, yeah. Little homage to Bruce Campbell.
You would see that. You would see people, you know, doing the posting that they're safe. Yes, you know.
Right, as they're taking selfies with zombies behind fences and stuff. And,
you could see that. Mm-hmm.
There is plenty of gore in this movie, folks. So if you are squeamish about that sort of thing, especially in the bowling alley scenes.
Yeah.
Oh, that was pretty rough, man. It's like whacking on either side of a head with a bowling balls, and it just breaks open the top of the head and brains go flying out. So, yeah. If that's
sort of
thing
bothers you. Yeah,
when they
knock off the snowman's head, it's spurting like, you know, like an artery, but
like a good body should.
Like a high blood pressure artery. Just, yes.
Yeah, it's not quite Japanese levels, but it's pretty high. Yeah, he was spurting pretty well.
And I love, Anna spurting. Can wield a good candy cane.
Her candy cane is pretty cool.
Yeah, I want that weapon.
It just reminded me of one of those big pens, though, you know.
It had to have been a solid candy cane because, most candy canes are made out of that wussy plastic and the first swing would shatter. But this one had to have been, a metal one because that was vicious. Her version of a crowbar. I want one of those.
I kind of liked and also didn't like the fact that, she gets blood on her face almost right at the beginning with the first kill. And no one in the film ever wipes off their face.
Right.
For the rest of the movie, they all have the splattered blood everywhere.
And that was one thing that we've thought was different from most zombie movies. If you got blood on you, you were doomed.
Right.
But this one, you actually had to be bit. So it obviously wasn't a bloodborne
virus. COVID.
It had to be a
saliva. It is COVID. It is.
Yes. Well, but saliva is not. No. I guess if you spit, that's true. You spit on someone. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it is. You had to be bitten by the zombie to get it. Yeah.
I just didn't know why. I mean, no one ever wipes their face or does anything to mess with that blood. It's all perfectly on there. And I didn't even check continuity on that. That would be hard to do.
Right.
To put the blood right back where it was.
But you were spot on that one, so that the one scene after they've danced through the graveyard, they've battled the snowman, and they end up in the playground.
Yeah.
Making snow angels.
Totally fake snow.
Yeah. And the trivia confirms it. So they were making a snow angel in Port Glasgow in the middle of a play park. And it was fake snow.
Yeah, it was pretty obviously fake snow. Oh, man, it totally ruined the movie for me.
I just hated that. Made you think, it must be a set. But it wasn't done in a set.
Mm-hmm. I have a note that I particularly, that's easy for me to say, particularly enjoyed the human voice song. So I'm going to put a little bit of that here. Isn't that a great song?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Is that your favorite song out of the...
I don't know. Most of these, I enjoy the songs within the movie. I'm not going to just sit and listen to the soundtrack over and over again.
I see what you mean.
I enjoy it in the scenes that they're in. And so I get emotionally involved in the scenes themselves, not so much the song.
Mm-hmm.
And that one was in an emotional scene. I mean, honestly, this isn't a really emotional heavy... I mean, when they tried, it kind of sort of worked, but didn't really work very much for me. I didn't take deaths too hard, even though there were some harsh ones.
Yeah.
It didn't really bother me that much, except for Grandma. Grandma got to me. That scene, that got to me a little bit. But
Yeah.
But anyway, I enjoy what I like to do during the songs and the dance sequences is to pick someone in the background and watch what they do.
Oh.
I enjoy doing that. So watch the scene, enjoy it for what it is, and then rewind and watch and just pick a character one of those background dancers and just watch what they do. And
so which one did you pick?
I picked, he wasn't so much too much in the background. He was more just a little bit to the side. So when they were in the dining hall, there was one kid who was going from seat to seat. They have little round seats, you know, cafeteria seats. And he's going, and he's just doing this spazzy dance, blah, 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 and he's hitting each of those. And I thought, he's going to miss one of those. He's going to miss, but he didn't. And then he turned around, and he went back, doing the same thing, going backwards, going the other way, I should say. And yeah, good on him. I don't know how many takes they did where he fell on his face, but at least he didn't in the final cut. Ding! Way to go, dude.
So yeah, I think definitely thumbs up movie that everyone has to watch. Now, as you're trying to decide, do I watch this as a Christmas show, as a family Christmas show?
Yes, absolutely.
I do want to share, you know, according to the Parents Guide, they give it a mild rating for sex and nudity. And just to warn you, yeah, we've definitely already talked about the kissing scenes. You know, the one song that has a big sexual innuendo.
The kissing scene.
But
like
also
I
be
care.
Warned, be warned that as Steph North is trying to get back her car keys, she comes across a dildo.
Yes,
in a box of
does.
Confiscated. Oh, yeah. And yeah, and they focus on that for quite some time. She, you know, grabs it, handles it. And, oh,
and goes,
yeah. And we have a zombie that gropes a teenager. Now, I'm trying to.
Really?
Yeah, I have to, we'll have to watch it again. I don't remember a zombie groping a teenager, but I guess they do. Yeah.
And Steph is a lesbian. Oh, no.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
She talks about a girlfriend. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? They're taking over.
Oh, yeah. That's awesome. I'm glad that they cover all. And also violence. They violence and gore. We've already talked about that. Lots of decapitations, lots of eating people, lots of impalements.
You know,
not a lot of strong language.
Pretty soon we'll just have movies that say zombie mayhem, and you know exactly what that means.
Yeah. The violence and gore was severe. Profanity they have is moderate. So we do a lot of, you know, they throw the F-bomb out there and a lot of, shits and hells and dams and,
Oh, now I'm going to have to edit the show.
Oh, I didn't say the F-bomb, though.
We don't
Isn't
have a rated
just
show.
F-bomb? Oh, we
don't. We just don't do it because we normally don't say that word.
But believe it or not, there is no alcohol, drugs, or smoking in this film.
Oh, fuck me.
Oh,
I'm
now
sorry.
You did it. Now you've got to change the rating. Oh, man. And there is, for frightening and intense scenes, they have it as moderate. So you do have some scary jump out, some jump scares, and some serious moments. Yeah. But all in all, this movie is more fun than scary.
One thing that I really enjoyed about John's character, let's talk just a little bit about him.
Okay.
Okay, the jerks are always giving him hell, right? And riding him. He never lets it get to him, and he's not intimidated by them in the least.
Yep,
he's
good
like
about
flipping
that.
Them off in their faces, and you know, he's not cowering from them or anything. He just kind of rolls with it, and I appreciated that. It was like, oh, he didn't go into a shell, and he didn't know, you know, woe is me. I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that. I'm just saying it was kind of cool in a movie like this to have him just say, oh, you guys are jerks. Screw you.
Yeah.
Flip
you
them
guys
off.
Aren't. Yeah, I'm the better. I'm the better man. I'm not rising to your lowering myself to your level.
Right. He's like blah blah blah. No one likes you either. So shut up.
I loved, and I guess that's another, I don't remember the whole song, but that's another one of my favorite parts of this movie is, so John, unfortunately, he sacrifices himself. I mean, he gets bit, so I'll spoil it. He gets bit.
Well, it just happenstance that he got bit. It wasn't defending anyone.
His time is coming, and so he sacrifices himself to make sure that Anna gets out of the,
Okay, that's what you meant. After he had been bitten, he did sacrifice himself.
So he sacrificed, her and they get, the survivors get out because of John. And I love later, as we're singing, another musical song part.
This is great.
Talking about the lights, and they scan to a shot of John propped up against a wall, and his arm twitches and it hits his Christmas shirt and on come the lights. And it's just
sweater lights up.
Yeah.
And he's full on zombie at that point, and he doesn't have any reaction to it, but it's just like,
I love it. But it just, went perfect, of course, with the song, because that's funny. What they meant it to do.
So what the hell? The cool kid who was her best friend gets killed, and she ends up going off with the ex-boyfriend jerk?
Yeah. What about that?
Guess this isn't a Hollywood ending, is it?
There's no such thing as a Hollywood ending.
Oh.
Yeah,
they did emphasize that.
They told us that right at the beginning, you know.
It was not a Hollywood. Yeah, they warned us right at the beginning that it wasn't going to have a Hollywood ending.
I love the headmaster's song. It's gleefully bad and hilarious. I'll put a little bit here.
Nothing's going to stop me now. Nothing's going to stop me now. It took me time to blossom, I know.
It's the best thing ever, even though his voice is terrible.
Yeah, his voice out of all the male actors is the worst.
Well,
but
it was supposed to be,
though. Supposed to be.
You know what? That's all the notes I have.
Wait a minute. What about the teens in penguin suits dancing to the fish song?
My favorite dish is fish, mother flipper, and I eat it for the hell of it. A nice bit of halibut. That's not the only fish they got.
But I think we covered it well, because I hope that we piqued everybody's curiosity, and I really, really do invite you, listeners, to please go watch this. I think we need to keep increasing the popularity of this film. We told our Courtney. To watch it. So she's put it on her watch list.
Yes. And she always does everything that we tell her to.
Yes, always.
Yeah. Always. Always.
No.
She's all grown up now, but...
Yeah, we want her to have her. Now, I don't think the same. I don't think Amber and Kevin would probably enjoy this as much. Mm-hmm. Courtney would.
And luckily, she sleeps with her phone right next to her in case we need to give her orders.
We don't get to do that.
What are you talking about?
You're terrible. Giving our listeners all kinds of false impressions today.
I'm not terrible. I've always demanded that she do fun things. So, no, I am zombied out, and I've been zombied out for several years now. We've done zombies to death. No pun intended.
Arr.
But this one, I'll make an exception for this one. It had some good kills. It had some great songs. It's funny. And it has its heart in the right place. And it's not cruel. And just good. Enjoyed it. Totally enjoyed it.
And just for people, so they reference a lot of other movies. They reference Snow White and the Seven Dwarves.
Of course, like you
movie.
Do.
Because they call one of the reindeer bashful. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, there's a whole running gag where John and Anna are trying to remember all the reindeer. And he finally gets it all at the end.
And like you said, the Evil Dead, like I said, for the evacu-selfies. Anna and the King, hence the title, Anna, the Apocalypse. Harry Potter, they mentioned Firebolt.
Yeah.
And of course, Iron Man, they mentioned, both John and Chris are gamers.
Yep.
Marvel. So yeah, Iron Man.
Mm-hmm. Yep, but not to an annoying degree. It's not just for the references. It just kind of adds to their characters.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Enjoyable.
Very enjoyable.
Anything else to add here at the end?
Watch it.
I think we've got that. If you've seen this movie, let us know what you think of it. Cavebabble@gmail.com. Would it kill you to write to us every now and then?
Arr. Well, if they're zombies, they can't.
Yeah, well, just I don't know.
I guess we presume microphone. All of our listeners are zombies.
Yeah, I guess so.
Zombie!
Or... head on over to our blog, cavebabble.com, and see the listing of our shows. That's pretty much what's there at this point. But you may join our Facebook group, search for Cave Babble Podcast, and ask to join, and we will accept you. Valerie is always accepting.
Always.
And once you do that, you will be issued your phone, and you have to hang on to it every night and listen for it, because we will call you, and we will give you instructions. I mean, we would really appreciate it. Thank you. You may subscribe.
Good morning. Get up and wash your hands.
That's right. Subscribe on iTunes now. Cavebabble Podcast. And if you like what you hear, give us a review. If you don't like what you hear, give us a review.
Let us know.
Yeah. We would
appreciate
that.
Let us know what you want to hear.
That's right. What do you want to hear?
What would you like us to babble about?
We'll tell you what you want to hear.
Yeah. Otherwise, we'll just keep going on oblivious. And
We already mentioned the Popcorn and Roses Network, which we are part of, with T.C. Kirkham and Kim Brown. Go to ecinema1.com and check that out. They have about a billion podcasts themselves, and they are our evil overlords.
Mm-hmm, yes.
And we sleep with our phones, and they give us instructions. So
I was going to say, I was wondering where you were going. That's with right. them. We sleep with them. Okay. Mm.
Yeah, and that all just rolls downhill, so get your phones now. Thanks, everyone, for all the downloads and listens, and until next time, Merry Christmas, by the way.
Yes, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays, Happy Hanukkah.
And please make sure they're zombies before you kill them. All right, thanks for all the downloads and listens, and we're out of here.
Goodbye.
Cave Babble.
Dasher, Dancer, mm-hmm. Bashful?
That's a dwarf. There's Olive. You know, it's in the song. Olive the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. Olive was a dick.
15 years, blowing the doors off the competition. Podcasting to planet Earth.
PMRNetworks.com